Hey, welcome back! With so many trends and especially electric vehicles requiring a massive amount of copper, this metal should play an even more important role in our future. Even though copper is not that cheap right now, I think it's better to prepare today and be ready in case a crash happens tomorrow. Now, with copper, similar to a majority of commodities, China plays a key role in the price. Even if the company you invest in has no business with China whatsoever, the country represents around half of the global demand, so if they have an issue, the total demand goes down and usually drags the price down with it. If I had to choose, I'd say this is more of a risk rather than an opportunity because you depend way too much on a single country, but in the future, according to studies and expectations, they should represent a smaller slice of the pie. But until then, or if it happens, China is probably the number one factor for the price. Speaking of studies, there is a 100 and something page study from S&P Global that looks into and is even named the future of copper. Among other things, they look into two scenarios based on the supply and demand for copper. As you can see, a lot of copper demand should come from EVs and the grid, infrastructure, storage and everything related to that, plus wind, solar and a bit of growth in the current uses. Now, in scenario 1, they expect a very significant 1.6 million metric ton gap between the supply and demand. To put it in perspective, the highest gap in about 25 years was around 1.25 million. Add the fact that they expect a whole decade of supply gaps before that and you can see the price of copper go up even more. However, this was the positive scenario. In the second, they see this gap reaching 9.9 million metric tons, which, I'm not kidding, could make the miners 100 beggars or even more. This kind of gap would be unheard of, but always take any estimation with a grain of salt. If you look into the study, I think they might have been a bit too optimistic with the supply growth, and I don't have to tell you how big the difference between a million and 10 would be. But even a gap of a million would be very good for copper, especially if it goes on for more than a decade. Anyway, more about that study and copper and nickel in this video. Right now, copper is not at its peak, but it's far from being cheap. As you can see in the study, this is a matter of supply and demand. Yes, in the long term, we know that there should be a pretty big increase in demand, but what about the supply? As you are about to see, after having a couple of good years, pretty much every copper company out there is investing in production capacity. And this is normal for any commodity. You know, prices go up, you make a lot of money, increase production, you disrupt the supply and demand balance, the price goes down, and so on. Even in the 10 million tons gap scenario, copper can still fall to 2.5 or 2 in a couple of years. A decade for commodities can even mean like 2 whole cycles, so we have to be ready. But we also have to think about the risks. If we see, for example, carbon nanotubes becoming a popular replacement, this can really affect the demand for copper. Normally, this kind of risk is impossible to predict or value, but at the very least, we can keep it in mind and look for a margin of safety. So, other technologies can affect the demand of copper. However, even if it gets replaced in one area, there are many others that can sustain the demand. I looked into lithium recently, but the issue with that is the fact that most of it is and will be used in batteries. If we get a technology that doesn't use lithium or uses less, then the price of lithium and the future of the industry can really be in trouble. From that point of view, copper is much more diversified. Now, remember that mining, especially if not in North America, Australia or the EU, poses a lot of risks. Take a look at Glencore's Wikipedia page, for example. You can't even fit the recent history of scandals on like 2 screens. Sure, the impact of these issues on the stock was not significant, but what if the next one is? Look, it's impossible to predict such an impact because any of these companies can just be some rich people's toy and once they are done or caught doing something bad, you are left holding the bag. In some cases, financials and every positive thing about a company would mean nothing. You know, not every company is like this, but this is a risk to remember. And you know, it can happen in any country. Now, let's begin with the biggest public copper producer, Freeport-McMoRan. This stock is a perfect representation of what you can expect from a copper mining company. They had more down 80%, up 400% or even more in a matter of months than probably any other big company you can find. I remember how back in 2020, with the fear caused by the pandemic, the stock fell to around 5 and everyone was afraid that they would go bankrupt or sell assets or stuff like that. However, exactly 2 years later, they were up around 850%, making it probably one of the best performers during that time. This is a classic commodity stock. When copper is low, nobody wants to buy them, but when the price of the commodity goes up, everyone tells you to buy them, and this is how they jump like 3, 5, 8 or even 10 times. They have projects in the Americas, especially North America, and Indonesia, all of these regions producing a pretty similar amount of copper. However, in Indonesia, they also mine gold as a byproduct, so even with relatively high royalties and duties, the net cash cost for copper in Indonesia is like 10 cents. By the way, this is both the second largest copper and gold mine on the planet, so you can see why they invested so much there recently. They provide this rough estimation of the operating cash flow, but only for copper at 4, 4.5 and 5, but what if it goes to 3 or 2.5? Well, that's when the issues might begin. Maybe they won't lose money, but what happens with all their projects? They'd probably have to borrow and just make the balance sheet worse. They estimate capex of 3.6 billion this year, but without Indonesia, which is another billion just for what you see on the screen. But this new project should be operational later this year or maybe next year, so in a couple of years the capex might normalize a bit. Now they can produce quite a bit of money. In 2021, when copper jumped to almost 5 per pound and stayed at around 4.5 for a whole year, they produced a free cash flow of 5.6 billion. This was also because they didn't have high capex, so you can say it was kind of a perfect year that started a pretty big investing cycle. Assuming that in the long term, the capex without a lot of investing normalizes at, let's say, 3 billion, which might be pretty high, they probably break even when copper is at around 2.5. This is a pretty good margin of safety. They have current assets of around 14 billion, which is enough to cover the 5.8 billion in current liabilities. The total liabilities reach around 25 billion, but with about 38.5 billion in long-term assets, I wouldn't worry too much. They target to give around half of the cash flow as dividends and buybacks, which is why in this case this metric is even more important. However, today this is very expensive. The market is trading it at like 11 times what they can produce in a very good year, which for the current capacity is a ratio of around 110. Keep in mind that 4 years ago the stock was at around 5, meaning 8 times cheaper than today. The company is okay, but definitely not a buy at this price. And look, the point of the video is to be ready for when the cycle goes down, not to find something to buy right now. You know, when they get to around 15 billion, meaning a price of around 10.5, then it might be time to accumulate. I know commodity companies can be pretty attractive and you get this kind of fear of missing out when looking at them in good years and they show you these estimations with copper growing so much, but these are commodities. Again, not even half a decade ago, the main headline was this company risking bankruptcy because copper fell below 2.5 for a couple of weeks. And this is investing in cyclical industries. Copper is at pretty high levels, but others, like lithium or platinum, are getting to very interesting prices. Anyway, getting to the second company, BHP. They are a diversified miner with operations in the Americas and Australia. They make money from iron, copper, coal, both metallurgical and thermal, and several others, including nickel and a big investment in potash. Potash is a very important mineral used in fertilizers, and this project would increase Canada's output by more than 20%, and Canada is by far the largest producer on the planet. So this is definitely something to keep in mind, especially since phase 1 should become operational in about a couple of years. They see the capex in the medium term reaching around 11 billion per year, but a lot of it is going into what they call future-facing commodities. They have 23.3 billion in current assets, which is enough to cover the 19 billion in current liabilities. They also have 78 billion in long-term assets, which is more than enough to offset the roughly 34 billion in long-term liabilities, if needed. They have a pretty big debt maturity coming this year, but after this it shouldn't be a problem. During a bad year, they can make a free cash flow of around 5 billion, 10 to 15 during average ones, and even as much as 20 to 25 billion in good ones. They target a dividend payout ratio of at least half of the profit, so on average you can probably expect something like $2-$2.5 per year. So a 3-4% dividend on average, which is better than McDonald's, J&J, Pepsi and so on, because you also get more potential to grow. They also target to gradually get out of thermal coal and focus on nickel, copper, potash and so on, which for me is definitely a plus. By the way, one thing to keep in mind about BHP and also Valley, there is a potential more than 50 billion fine for a dam failure from about a decade ago. Plus one of the biggest class action lawsuits in history, claiming about 45 billion for the same event. We can't know the outcome and this has been going on for quite a few years, but it's definitely a risk. Once again, 160 billion for this is maybe too much, but something like 100 or 80, meaning a stock price of around 30-40, is much more interesting. Now let's look into Glencore. Talking about cyclicality, this company's graph is the perfect example. They have a pretty interesting dividend and buyback policy because they pay a fixed 1 billion plus a minimum 25% of the free cash flow if they meet the net debt target. A year ago they paid back around 9.3 billion in dividends and buybacks, meaning a return of around 14%. The issue with the buybacks is that they don't really think too much when they do them. Obviously, if they have money, it's during a good year. If it's a good year, the stock is up, so they waste a lot of money on buybacks at the wrong time. They mine pretty much the same as BHP, meaning mostly coal, copper, zinc and nickel, with operations everywhere on the planet. They mine copper at very cheap prices when including the byproducts, but I want to emphasize once again the risk of investing in this kind of company. Will the new management be any different? Who knows? Anyway, normally they spend about 4 billion in capex, but once again we can see a lot of investing following a couple of good years. Recently they had this 7 billion acquisition of Teck's met coal business and this is getting me to a point I want to make. As you probably know, there is thermal coal used for energy and there is metallurgical coal used in the steelmaking industry to make coke. Now both of them pollute a lot, but for thermal you have nuclear power, gas, solar, wind and so on if you want a more eco-friendly alternative. However, with met coal there isn't really some widely accepted alternative that would make sense from a financial point of view. You can use hydrogen for example, but who'd produce enough, who'd transport it, who'd store it and so on. If you think about it, replacing this with anything should be done with a lot of care because even a 10-15% increase in the price of steel can lead to a global financial crisis. However, with the direction we can see with China and every other major economy phasing out of coal in the following decades, this is a pretty risky industry to be in. I think met coal is maybe a hold in my opinion. If you have the production capacity, use it and maybe look into selling it, but definitely don't buy it now. Now, you know, the phasing out is gonna take more than 2 decades and they paid like 4 or 5 times the EBITDA, so maybe it's not that bad, even though it's more than you normally see coal companies being sold for. In a good year, they can make even as much as 10-12 billion in free cash flows, but keep in mind that coal is the number one source of income. And this is before the acquisition. Normally, I'd expect around 5-6 billion per year. They have 57 billion in current assets and 45 in current liabilities, but most of this is in inventories, which could be a problem. Overall, not that great when adding the acquisition. And this is my general opinion about Glencore. Talking about Teck, they are a pretty big copper miner as well as the number one producer of zinc, with operations in the Americas. They have a very good production cost, which is one of the main advantages you can look for in a mining company. About the Glencore deal, Teck is going to keep the money that the company makes until it's over in Q3 this year, assuming that it doesn't somehow get blocked. That's another 1 billion in cash flows expected. After the deal, they want to focus on reducing the debt, funding the growth of their copper operations and even pay a significant dividend. More on this will come after the transaction, but if they give half of that money, that's like a 20% dividend. What's left is basically the good stuff that Glencore was willing to overpay quite a lot for. So Teck is definitely the winner in this deal. Zinc has a lot of uses, from galvanizing and alloys to batteries, fertilizers, paints, coatings and so on. The price is kinda similar to that of steel, since galvanizing represents more than half of the demand, but there is a bit of potential to grow thanks to batteries. So from this you can expect a bit of long-term growth with a normal volatility. However, Teck's zinc mines seem to be pretty old and they are assessing if they should go for life extension options right now. Anyway, they invest a lot and divesting coal and focusing on copper is really what I want to see from a company in this position. Even before selling the coal business, they plan on doubling the copper production in about a year from now, reaching a capacity of around 600,000 tons. Right now it's very tough to estimate how much they can make. Call is basically over half of the company, so all the data before the transaction is highly impacted by the price of call. We can see an estimated impact of changes in the prices of copper and zinc. In the future, if the production gets to 600 for copper and 700 for zinc, the impact should be roughly around $8.5 for copper and 6 for zinc. What it means is that a $1 change per pound in the price would increase or decrease the profit by around 850 million for copper and 600 for zinc. By the way, $1 for zinc is massive, but for copper, it's not unheard of. In the future, a majority of their income will come from copper, from the looks of it. They also plan to have a base dividend of 50 cents per share plus 30 to even 100% of the cash flows that would be left. That's a minimum of 1.2% plus maybe even as much as 5-6% for the current price. And this is before the transaction. The balance sheet is, again, impacted a lot by coal. Adding a bit below 9 billion in cash after taxes, they could pay back a significant amount of debt. What's left is a low-cost copper and zinc producer without a lot of debt and a decent amount of growth thanks to quite a few projects. This is definitely something to look into after the transaction is approved. Now, the fifth company in today's video, Southern Copper, has the lowest production cost. What's even more interesting is the duration of their reserves. They have mines in Mexico and Peru, and they have probably the largest reserves on the planet, lasting around 6 decades at the current production rate. To put it in perspective, they have around half more copper than Codelco or Freeport, which are massive companies in comparison. So this is a lifetime worth of low-cost copper. With the current assets of around 4.5 billion covering the current liabilities more than 3 times, they shouldn't have short-term issues, and from the looks of it, the long-term should also be fine. They can make a free cash flow of around 2 billion on average, plus or minus 1-1.5 in good or bad years. Again, not attractive today, but so far in bad times they went to around 10 times the average, which would also be my buying target. That's a price of around 25 to 30 per share. You know, it's very tough not to make money when you literally mine cheaper than almost everyone else on the planet. The dividend is what you can expect from this kind of company, and if you buy around 30, you get pretty much double digits in good times. They also do buybacks from time to time, but nothing too impressive. A downside I have to mention is that 88.9% of this company is owned by Grupo Mexico, so you depend on whatever they decide. Imagine you buy today, the stock crashes in half, and they decide to make it private. Even if you buy at very low prices, they can cut you out whenever they want, and you miss out on all the upside. This is a very serious risk to consider, especially if copper becomes an even stronger commodity from a political point of view. They also produce a bit of silver, zinc and molybdenum, but copper is the main focus. Once again, lots of investments are coming, so think about the supply and demand balance for copper. Will the demand really keep up with all the extra production? A few days ago, a company backed by Bill Gates and Jeff Bezos even discovered a high-grade copper reserve in Africa that could become one of the top 3 mines on the planet. This kind of thing could even balance that supply gap in a decade from now, so don't invest thinking it's something guaranteed to happen. Anyway, balancing the risk and reward, this is still a pretty good company to keep in mind. In my opinion, copper is probably one of the best metals from an investing perspective. It's very useful today, and it should be even more useful for EVs, smart cities, 5G and so many other future trends. These companies are okay, but again, not a buy at the current price. When copper falls to like 3 again, then we might see some real opportunities. Today, the market seems to be pretty hyped about copper, and as a result, many copper miners are traded at more than they should. But you know how commodities and the market can be, so things can be very different even in a couple of months. If we get into a recession, this type of company is definitely on my buy list. As always, what I cover in my videos shouldn't be enough for you to make any investment decision, so please do your own research before investing in anything. If you want to see more videos like this one, please leave a like and even a comment to help me out, and make sure to subscribe. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.